Hi, we're Jaded, aka the Pancake Boys. Yeah. I'm Nari.
I'm Teo.
I'm Jordan.
And today we're gonna deconstruct our track Pancake for you, featuring the lovely Ashnikko. You might know this track from, it was on an Apple advert, the Apple Watch. It's been on a few adverts. It's got about. So yeah, we thought, why not? It's quite a unique track to deconstruct. It's got some quirky vocal parts, some interesting drums and bass parts. So yeah, let's take you through this. Let me bake. Alright, so what is a pancake bitch? A pancake bitch is actually a message about body positivity. And a pancake bitch is someone who might be a lady that's flat chested, but she still gets the cake. So yeah, a pancake bitch is about kind of giving an empowering message about accepting your own body and just being okay with that image and just plowing through life.
The way we actually recorded the vocal, we're in a completely different project. Actually, you go with us.
Yeah, so we did this a lot slower. So the version that's out now is like housey. But the version that we originally did was just like on like an electro hip hop beat.
Yeah, a lot slower because a lot of artists tend to find it difficult to rap on this kind of speed. So we normally slow it down, get them to rap over that or write to that kind of tempo beat and then bring it into a new project.
And also whenever you record vocals slower and then you speed them up, like you get all the little kind of
gives it nice kind of like
all the grooves and everything just tighter, and it just sounds a bit better.
So I think in general rappers they tend to not really like the idea of 4/4 kick drums as well.
No, yeah, throws them off a bit. Yeah,
so really this was how we did it. It was at like 115 BPM.
No time to waste my time, I'ma make them wait. I'm a pancake bitch, but I take cake. Gooey in the middle, baby, let me bake. No time to waste, I'ma waste my time, I'ma make them wait. I'm a pancake bitch, but I take the cake. Gooey in the middle, baby, let me bake. I just wanna ride right now. Everybody wanna take a bite right now. Ain't no time like the time right now.
So that's how it started, and then it ended up as...
We're just gonna give him a...
Go, don't give him a drop. Give him the vocal.
0.5 snippet there.
Give him
this. What we're gonna do is we're gonna go through the drop and everything that went down, because that's where the majority of the meat in terms of samples are. And then we're gonna go back and show you what it is. But we got some of the vocals over the second part of this drop, and then we're gonna go over to the middle eight, which was taking what you just heard on that slower beat. We took the second half of that verse and made a middle eight of it, and then we chopped off the first part and basically made the overall hook slash chorus of it. The main part that everyone seems to remember and sings along and whatnot. And once we got that over the actual beat, then we got her in to go and record the verses and filling in all the other parts, but by then we already had our meat. But anyway, going into the production, so we recorded the verses and everything that we need to do, and then basically started this track from scratch. It started from a beat that I'd made earlier, well, maybe a year before actually, we delved into it and got the horns from it. So we took some horn samples and a few other things that we liked, regurgitating tunes that never get finished to make a final product. Feel free to delve back into years of tunes that you made in the past in order to actually get that result. Do you know what I mean? In the end, do what you gotta do to make that tune hit.
They don't always go to waste, man.
It really
doesn't. You always bring them back.
One way or another, we've always make something work out of something, don't we? So generally, just starting off with the kick drum. I mean, I remember when we were making the track, we had all these different kick drums and all these different layers. We had the top, we had the mid, we had the low, and it was just getting a little bit much. So I remember we scrapped everything and just had this kick. Generally quite punchy with the top and everything that you need. We rolled out a little bit, 29 hertz, I guess. I'm not really sure exactly what that was doing at the time. And we had the SSLG channel just to add a little bit of 3K in the mid and that. And the high as well, I believe that we've done something like that. Not much, but just enough to kind of, in general, this SSLG channel waves I put on everything really in the
end. Gives it that extra oomph and just extra punch, you know, just makes it cut through the mix.
And yeah, so we did that, and then it actually looks like we've gone and bust this to bus 19. If I recall, it was a sausage fattener. I believe it was a sausage fattener. Let's have a look at this quickly. It's you let me know out of all these buses you find
yeah, bus sausage 19. Fattener.
Yeah, sausage
old
fattener.
Trusty.
Old trusty. Old trusty sausage fattener.
Wait, is it on 6% or 8%? Wait, go on, hit that.
Is it, was that, was it?
The fatness is on 6%.
Yeah, the fatness is both on 8, okay. Yeah. Very meticulous there.
Always around 6 to 8% and you get that.
But in general, yeah, this thing just gives you the juice and that's what we use for the juice. Right, so we had that. In general, we got the claps here. We got a couple of layers here. We got the clap with this one clap layer. Then we got a wide clap layer, which we put a CLA on it. Generally, we put a CLA on one or two layers of a clap just to kind of give it that stereo width. You've got this pitch thing here. Generally, if you need a little bit more high-end snap on these claps, generally we'll put a CLA on just to give it the width, because we want
presence, doesn't it?
Exactly. I mean, you want to do everything down the middle, but then also I always find that when you're mixing a track down, at some point the clap's gonna have to have some sort of width in order for everything to make sense in the mix. So we did that. More claps. This one's got a bit more of like a thick round bottom. I mean, we've gone and cut out quite a lot of it and boosted in the 6K. Cool, yeah, why not? Yeah, some I mean, generally, as a rule of thumb, you're not really supposed to be boosting frequencies with any of your stock sounds. It's supposedly a bit of a faux pas.
But if it sounds good, man.
If it sounds good, it sounds good. We're not too precious around there. I think these drums are a good testament to the fact that you don't have to waste your time parallel compressing things and whatever it is these people do these days. We've got the hi-hat here. We just had a single one. We had a transient master on it, but we didn't actually end up using that. We've got the shaker, which...
A lovely shaker.
A lovely shaker. Actually is nothing without this bit crusher. We've driven it there. And the downsampling is only on the one, but the resolution is that. If you take it off, you can hear what you're dealing with there. It really brings it to life.
It's another thing I would say about this shaker is that what we did is that if you see, we have a transient master in there, but I think we already had a transient master on another channel, and then we bounced into this. You just take the attack off a little bit of the shaker, and it just gives it that little shh. Just gives it that little kind of swoop in. Yeah, just swipes in nicely. Just gives, I mean, it sits kind of behind the hi-hat, so it's just grooves nicely.
We for the percussion sounds, this is actually the main percussion. Generally, the way our sound generally was, at least at this time in our lives, simple, bouncy, characterful as well. So, I mean, generally, the way we work, we just go and chuck a whole load of crap on there and get what we need to be done, and then we sit on it for a day and realize that 3/4 of that will not end up making the cut. Do you know what I mean? Sometimes it's up to this guy here to just say enough is enough and get rid of everything. Which is good.
Sometimes we'll program it in just with the normal sounds, or Nari will jump on the percussion and record it in live and then see what fits, and we might program what he recorded live with other sounds, but you know, switch up.
Yeah, so for the main percussion sound, we didn't actually record it. We got the sample from one of many thousand sample packs we collected in our time. This is...
So this is from the Bongo Barry pack.
The Bongo Barry pack, exactly. That may or may not have just been made up now. We don't know. But anyway, yeah, it's a simple rhythm. Surprisingly enough, though, we just cut off 108 hertz, and what I'm surprised that we have a sound shifter going up 4 semitones. Generally, as a rule of thumb, I would have to say that pitching up a sample, in particular a drum sample, up 4 semitones is never going to really be good for like the flamming of it all. You never really know what you're going to get, so I wouldn't advise it. Usually what we do is we get a battery 4, if you want to know what it is. And we usually pitch up our samples that way, tuning them, what we have to do to get it done.
And we did this the lazy way because it was from the other project, and then we're trying to make it fit and make it all in tune. Do you know what I mean? Like, it was like from an old beat, and then that old beat was 4 semitones lower than this, so we just banged the sound shifters on and lifted everything up 4 semitones.
Yeah, okay. usual story there.
But if you see, we've done the old trusty trick of adding a bit of bit crush and overdrive to mask. The fact that
Yeah, so the sound if up. Something's not working, obviously mask it with a bitch crusher and a bitch crusher. Edit that or not, it's up to you. A bit crushing and overdrive, yeah, generally that would do that. But I would say generally we wouldn't do that, but actually it's yielded great results in this case. I mean, if you actually listen to the sample, it's very nice and clean. So I'd have to say, once again, there's not really any rules you have to stick to. And we've gone and bust the CLA to that, which seems to be giving it a little bit of stereo width, but it looks like we've just tried to put a little bit of that treble bite in to make it punch through the mix, which it actually does lovely. Let's never go. Okay. You get the idea. We got all the rhythms of the bass going with that as well, so it was imperative that we get that particular perk sample right going into the next bit as well. This is another one here that we bounced down. It's actually here. This is the original sample. And that is going through a battery. Yeah, like we said earlier, this is exactly what we do to pitch our samples. So this one here. So there we go. And yeah, generally, I would say if you really want to get your drums tight, battery's the way to go. You want to make sure that you have the control to be able to like deal with the attack and the decay of everything. That's how you get your drum sounding tight, making sure it's all tuned in with exactly what's going on with the melodies and the bass, etc. So that's that. Moving on. We have we got a cowbell going in for the second half of that as well.
Doing the counter rhythms,
exactly. It sounds really nice and punchy. And we have that once again, bust to a sausage fattener. And again, I think at the time we were loving the sausage fattener. So we got the perks, we've gone through all of that. Right, what else do we have? We got the standard crashes and whatnot. So now moving on to the bass, what we have for the bass, we had everything going to that same rhythm of the pluck. We actually have a bass mixed with a perk sample that's obviously been bounced in place. So we got that, and we put a Saturn on that to give that just a basic saturation. Oh, the preset's actually basic saturation. There we go. Yeah, generally Saturn for saturation, can't really beat it. Generally, this is the go-to for making anything sound that little bit grittier and giving it some texture. I'm all for that plugin.
How many bass sounds are we like?
We got about four, I believe. We got this layer here. Okay, this.
That's the curve bass.
This is the curve. I'll go through all of these basses here. We got this one here, which I believe is a. We got a serum. And then to make the horns hit, the horns which we'll get to, we had this bass which we sampled from another track that we had. And this is just the one hit that just really makes everything hit and gives the horns the juice they need. But yeah, generally for the bass, we were using a curve.
This is for that donk sound, play it.
Generally for any of the FM sounds, generally we're using this lovely donkiness. This spire, what else are we using for the FM donks, really?
That's mainly this.
Just the logic one, the standard logic one as well. It's got like a.
And we're also, we bounced in place all of these, but we actually chuck on an R bass nearly everything. If something's not sounding quite up to scratch with like sitting in with the mix, generally we'll just toss an R bass.
You can actually get like the thinnest, most average bass sound and just put an R bass on it. Mm. And it will just slap.
I mean, even in the past, I've actually gone and like bounced whole drum parts together and put an R bass on it or whatever.
Just pull that threshold down.
Yeah, generally it's not a good idea, but do what you want. And so now
the serum sound, show them the.
Oh yeah, we got the serum sound as well, which is this was the, I think it's just a standard It's the standard preset that comes in with Serum, but I like this one because it has the velocity of the notes controls the cutoff and the resolution, so you can get all these different tones. So depending on what the velocity is of the notes, you can get a harsher tone, a little subtone. But generally what I like about this 303 preset in particular is it's got nice harmonics and you can control the harmonics.
It gives it that top layer to your bass. And if you see, we've added a bit of release here, just so that it's got a bit of a tail as well. And
it's a nice little juice.
We had a bit of, actually we really struggled with the bass on this tune because we wrote the song in B. And do you remember, like, it just never hit.
Was it hitting?
Yeah, because the thing is, man, with like bass notes, it's like if you're around like B, B flat, C, it's like it's not really gonna like cut through and it's not really gonna give you that body. So it's like we're struggling because it was all like B, B, B. And then spoke to one of my friends and it was like, why don't you just try like drop it down to like every like two bars, just go down to like the fifth, the relative fifth, which is F sharp. And F sharp is like the sweet spot for bass, right? Just like really like gives it that sub. So like, yeah, if you pay attention, it just goes dun, dun, dun. It goes like B, 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 and then F sharp, which gives it that kind of the cajonas.
Which where the cajonas.
You know what I mean? Yeah, so you want to play it, just show
it. Well, actually
just,
it is. It's the contact patch as well.
We've got like an 808 going
These
in there.
808s, this newer new era 808 bass, gives it serious cajonas, as he would call it. And the relative notes he's talking about are these.
I think it was going to the MIDI. Highlight that. I think it was B and F sharp. Highlight all of them.
Let's see down here.
F sharp. F sharp. And then the other one was a B.
And these were all supplementing some of the percussions that we had as well, because everything was just about making the bounce of the percussions sit right across the whole tune. And yeah, taking it down to that is what really gives it the beef. But yeah,
and we tuned all the percussion to kind of supplement that F sharp note as well. So when it all went down, it all just went down and just hit nicely.
Yeah, but yeah, generally nice meaty bass. So
that's the BS.
We got the horns now. So what we've gone and done is we've actually, well, the actual original horns that we had, let me find them, were these ones, just a little crusty sample that I found on an old tune of ours. Here we go. Not really saying much, but actually the rustiness of the whole sample kind of is the appeal. I panned it left and right for no apparent reason. And yeah, there's one that's an octave higher and one that's just an octave lower. And what did we do with these? These were then bounced in place and brought up to here, where they then got a lot more of a high-end grip. We got to bust these down to an auxiliary channel where we put our Saturn on it again. I think it was the same preset, basic saturator. And then we actually have it bust quite heavily again to two other channels, which I believe were...
Tons of shit.
Some of the buses that are going on here is quite... this one's quite interesting. Yeah, so we got the transient master there to kind of give it a bit more attack and give it a little bit of crispness and crispness. the other bus was a Kramer tape, which gives you, it's a tape saturation emulation. I mean, to be honest with you, if I was to tell you exactly what goes on with this plugin, I couldn't tell you, but it sounds good. Makes everything sound nice and warm. You can mess around with the flutter a little bit to give that kind of tape emulation. And yeah, basically gives it grit, brings it up, gives it more presence in the mix. And that's exactly what we were looking for at the time.
25 and 26.
25 and 26, yeah. 26 with the Kramer tape.
Cool.
So yeah, generally these horns got bounced again just to give it a bit more of that high-end crispness. So these are the horns. And then these were horn samples that we had taken from another track as well, which are also bussed to that same 24 with the saturator and the Kramer tape. We actually layered them. Well, let's see what these are. Right, so this was actually a horn lick that we had from another tune, which then actually got supplemented with a Serum, if I recall, which is that sound there. I'll try and find that Serum. I don't know exactly where it is. I believe it's definitely around. But yeah, anyway, we had our horn lick. Yeah, here we go. this was what we did to, yeah, generally with our serum patches, really, we don't go into too much detail, but generally if I'm going to be doing anything, I'm going to be messing around with the ADSR, detune it where needed, give it a little bit of white noise, depending on what white noise I use, but that's generally what we're doing to switch it up when we're going through serum. But yeah, that was needed because the horn sample wasn't really cutting through the mix, so we needed to have a little bit more of a little bit of a low end grit to it. So in the end, we just replayed the notes of what was going on in the horn sample.
It gives it a bit of a playfulness as well. Like, it makes it, I don't know.
And we've actually gone and bounced all of that again and pitched it up an octave, I believe. That's actually the same sample, believe it or not. But yeah, this one here, this is actually chopped up. This sample here has actually got one octave and then another octave on top, bounced in place together, because before it just didn't have any presence, so we had to do that. And then, yeah, going into the lead, generally the lead was a funny one because we were literally just going back and forth on leads and didn't know what we wanted. Every melody that we did was amazing and crap at the same time. We didn't know what we wanted to do, so it took us a while to actually get there, but in the end we just stuck with this lead. But in the end, to be honest, it was the right lead, because as time goes on, it's a memorable lead, it's catchy, you can chant to it, you know what I mean? Yeah. You can hum along to it, and it gets the job done in terms of what a lead.
Creates a moment, man, and I feel definitely like creates tunes a need a moment, because a lot of people just like do build-ups, just like go into some like noisy drops. Like, yeah, you could do that, but also you could just have a moment, something that's like a sing-along, doesn't have to be a vocal.
Acts as another hook, doesn't it? We've got the vocal hook, and then we've got the lead.
Yeah.
It's just...
Yeah, we actually had, in terms of the actual lead, we had about 7 or 8 different serum patches, all doing different plucks, and it was just all getting a bit much. So we've consolidated it down to the 3 main ones, which is this. Right, so that was the lead. Generally what we've got actually gone and done is, I'll show them, these are the 3 here. If you hear them, I mean, we bounced them in place and then did some extra processing after that. But this is how one of them sounds. The more belly aspect of it. And then the next one was a bit more of like a hollow one that was a little less attack, but more to just fill certain frequency ranges. And then we have our old trusty, we put an 808 Tom into an EXS, and it's called Tom BB, and it's been the 808 sample that we've just been putting in an EXS.
But it's like the crappiest 808 song you can imagine. It's like it's kind of out of tune. The tuning, we still don't know. We've always like, for years, we were like, is this 20 cents low or high? Which one is it?
So okay.
But it always works. You just put it in the mix and it's somehow.
Well, usually we don't know. When you go to the EXS, you don't know really if we're going to be fine-tuning it to the right or to the left. But I can confirm for once, we've actually left it as it is, which I guess might have just added to a little bit of detuning, which, you know what I mean, it's never really a bad thing as long as things aren't like drastically phasing and whatnot. In this case, it wasn't to the left and it wasn't to the right, so... Happy days.
Yeah, but play it.
But yeah, and that's this.
Pitched up high, man.
Pitched up high,
yeah. Usually. For bases and stuff.
But yeah, I mean, it can get used for anything. It's just one of our weird things. And then, do you want to go
It's got a lot of girth down at the low end.
Yeah, I mean, generally, as producer, because we all produce, but generally the one key rule that we have is that it must have girth. And anyway,
tip of the week.
Exactly, yeah. All right, so this, and then we eventually bounced and placed these things, and the first one, they're all getting bounced, they all got bus to bus 22, and that has another bus going.
I think there's probably automation on that gain, so like whenever where the drop ends, that gain gets turned on and like cuts everything off.
Well, there's a gain. There's a utility gain at the end, but yeah, sausage fattener again, a little bit of EQ and cut out any unwanted frequencies, and a Kickstarter, which, believe it or not, we haven't used as much as we usually do, but Kickstarter gets used for everything. It kind of just got to a point with sidechaining where it was just sidechain compression was just adding all these unwanted transients and whatnot, and I just got sick of always not having a true understanding of what the kick was actually sounding like, so I kind of got a bit fed up of it. kickstart is a great way to not have to use sidechain compression.
If you're not trying to get the sucking effect of sidechain,
yeah,
kickstart is good. But if you're actually trying to get that like effect from sidechain, this kickstart doesn't really do that. It's more about like it's more like a ducking thing, like an LFO too almost.
Yeah, so there's no processing done on this pluck. This pluck is the same there. And then this one was
a little micro shifter.
So you put a micro shifter in here. Generally, this kind of gives it a little bit of chorusy whip. Should we call it?
Yeah, this one's a good chorus, kind of good chorus effect. Another one's the Tao one, T-A-O chorus. That's really good. It gives it that kind of like the Juno chorus effect that you get on those classic synths. But yeah, that's just the kind of widen it. What's on that?
This is actually an amalgamation of the three bounced together. And then on top of the little micro phaser or whatever it is, we also put another bus quite heavily with a phaser. So there was a lot of phasing going on there, and that was to give it this.
How much phaser we got now?
I mean, you tell me. Generally with phasers, I'm tossing things on there without knowing.
Takes off.
I will take it off.
So not that much, really.
Yeah, it's not much.
Yeah, there's not that much phaser on there, but at the end of the day, sometimes you need to just tweak these things ever so slightly to get that mix right. Right, so yeah, that's the plucks, as far as I'm concerned. Now, we have a few other little vocal chops in here. We have one chop that actually sounds pretty much identical to Ashnikko, so we thought, why not? It'd be criminal to not pop that in. No, that's not the one I'm talking about. That's another one that we have just filling in the gaps. We have this one here, which... This one sounds very similar to the artist. Everyone seems to think it was Ashnikko, but it was actually from like a Jamaican dancehall loop pack. I guess Ashnikko, Rihanna is the same thing, isn't it? Shout out to Ashnikko and Rihanna. I see you, baby. For the most part, that's what we did for the beef of the track. Then we have the vocals. Now, how do you want to go about these vocals? Because there's different parts. We got the chorus here. I mean, it might be about... I mean, this is the main hook anyway.
There's mad chain, mate. Look at these chains. Oh, I love it, love it.
Oh, hello, hello. Oh, wait. All right, this is the vocal mix master extraordinaire.
I'm not that guy.
I'll let him take over. I mean, you say you're not that guy, you got three compressors, a couple of Pro Qs.
We've got a little compressor. It's not doing much, really. We like to compress in like little bits. We compress an EQ, kind of just tiny amounts. Take a bit there, 100 hertz, just a few dips here. Another compressor. Again, not doing much, man. Just play it to you first, you know we're in. So.
I'm the sauce and spaghetti, put it on, you kinda heavy. Listen to me, get a semi-country bitch up in her Chevy. Do me right or do me never, make you sweat up in your sweater. Don't get cocky, don't get clever, don't get cheesy on me. I'm the sauce and spaghetti, put it on, you kinda heavy. Listen to me, get a semi-country bitch up in her Chevy. Do me right or do me never, make you sweat up in your sweater.
Don't get cocky,
don't get clever, don't get cheesy on me. I'm sorry.
Anyway, what have you got to do to get
and,
that?
There's another one, again, taking a dip here. Listen to me, get a semi-country bitch up in her Chevy. Do me right or do me never, another compressor, like, doing nothing really, man, just tiny amounts. Don't get cheesy on me. Another DSR. This was a really good DSR, actually. They're Fatal to Pro DS.
I guess we did that though because we did speed it up. And you know what? You can hear that in it still a little bit now, but it gives you that character.
But if you hear, like, got like a I'm a little radio tone out. Put it on you kind of heavy. Listen grit. To me get a semi country bitch up in her Chevy. Do this me bad right boy. Or do me never make you sweat up then, in yeah, your sweater. Don't you try
I mean generally Fab Filter Sound Toys, you get those two.
Oh yeah, you put a double on that.
You got nothing else to you got a double on that.
It's a bit of whip, you know? It just sits there, you can barely hear it. Look. You know, just a bit more whip. I'm a sauce and spaghetti and put it on you kinda heavy. Listen to me. I'll compress it again. Tiny amount. Just if you see there's about like four or five compressors on, when they're like all kind of add to each other, slowly it gives you that effect. Whereas if you were to put just like one huge compressor on and just like go in on it, it's not gonna be as loud as you would it would be like this. Then what else we got? Little delay here.
Shout out to the age delay.
Age delay, always comes correct. So a little delay here so they can go. 16D ping pong, just to give it that little flutter effect. With age delay, you have to be careful, turn this analog off, otherwise it just gives you that shh, white noise, like you'll be making a tune, an hour later, you're like, where's that white noise coming from? It's from this guy.
That knob's the devil.
This, turn this fucking off. Low cut a little bit, and that's it. Just kind of medium feedback.
We also got, you got the the middle eight part as well. There's like a...
Yeah, we chopped up the...
What's on these bus doublers? Age today. Oh yeah. No time to waste. Waste my time. I'ma make them wait. I'm a pancake bitch, but I take again, so the cake. Got a bit, I'm gooey in the middle, baby, let me bake. No time to waste. Waste my time. I'ma make them wait. I'm a pancake bitch, but I take the cake. I'm got that on it.
The wheel of death.
We're back. This is probably my favorite reverb to use, man. I'm not gonna lie. This is a bad boy reverb, you know. Probably got this automated, I think. Yeah.
I'm gonna need you to put that on my computer.
Nah. You gotta buy it yourself, man.
Actually, now you got a few things you need to give me.
Nah, I paid for these, so you should pay for your own.
Hey, listen, I'm expecting it to rain on, man.
Unless Valhalla, like, spot. Valhalla, sponsor him, he needs some bits.
Valhalla, please.
Help man out. all right, so if you can see, you've got the mix here, just.
No time to waste my time, I'ma make them wait. I'm a pancake bitch, but I take the cake. I'm gooey in the middle, baby, let me bake. No time to waste my time, I'ma make them wait. I'm a pancake bitch, but I take the cake. I'm gooey in the middle, baby, let me bake.
Very lightly.
It's tiny amounts, man, but in the grand scheme of things.
In general, this mix in the end, it was full of a million little subtleties, which isn't necessarily the way we usually do things, but it just happened.
And then another trick I've got is that whenever I've got a vocal, if I wanted to just like add a bit more character to it, put the -3 semitones. So it's not an octave, it's not a seventh or a fifth, it's a third. So a third just gives a different tone. Just no time to waste. Just waste sits my time, I'ma make 'em wait. Together. My pancake bitch, but I take the cake. I'm gooey in the middle. Kind of sounds like when you're rapping, you got like your fatter, lower tone cousin just behind you, just rapping along with you, you know?
Yeah.
Gives you that confidence. Anyway, so that's the chorus for gender, no time to waste. Waste my time, I'ma make them wait. I'm a pancake bitch, but I take the cake. I'm gooey in the middle, baby, let me bake. No time to waste. Waste my time, I'ma make them wait. I'm a pancake bitch, but I take the cake. I'm gooey in the middle, baby, let me
bake. I mean, you got the, I mean, the verses, they've all got the same process.
Yeah, they got
anyway,
the same effect.
But there's that, do you want to go into this one, I think? Well, I don't know, there's one of them that has the...
what's on this one? This one has actually... Yeah, same. So, oh wait, no, this one. Right, so this one, second verse, for some reason I ran it through a guitar amp as well. Pay attention. So there's an amp. Oy. Yeah, so we recorded this second verse actually after we did the, like after we kind of had this version, we were like, oh shit, we need a second verse now. Do you know what I mean? Because this was kind of, like, this is like a commercial radio house tune, I guess. So we needed a second verse just so that it can be played on radio. And yeah, once we added, I think we did it with a different vocal mic. So we just wasn't getting the effects. So I was like, you know what, fuck it. I'm just gonna put an amp on it. But that amp obviously ended up giving some nasty noises. So we took out around this region.
Surprised you used the Logic amp.
Hey, it's alright, man.
Who's mixing, switching places, 7 minutes in my basement. Sticky hands, hands waving, scabby knees up on the pavement. Engines revving on location, did the lap, he thinks we racing.
Except.
Right, we got the, I just want to rag right now. Yeah. I got to find that one as well, because I think there's some sort of
Another trick I would say, if you can't get your vocals, if you've like recorded the vocal and then like you've gone and finished the song like a year later and recorded another set of vocals, a good way of being able to match vocals is this thing called match EQ. So you can just like send something to an EQ.
Who's mixing, switching places, 7 minutes.
So it learns that. It learns that basically, and then you go. So that's your current, and then let's say you add a reference to it, which is like slightly different. Let's say we take the amp off.
Who's mixing, switching places, 7 minutes in my basement? Sticky hands, hands wave.
So you take that, and then you match it, and then it does this. So it takes the reference and your current, and then it adds the reference to your current, and it just like creates an identical sound and thing. Because basically with EQ, you can kind of achieve any sound you want. With EQ and compressors, you could basically achieve any sound you want. Mm. And that's that. Cool. What's next? We've got
the
middle eight part, you said? So
go back to that bit though. So what went down with this? This is actually the vocal that we have to introduce the song before everything actually starts. And we actually don't have it here, but we actually bounced down with everything that we had. Nari's just showed you with all the processing and everything. We bounced that down and put it through. But actually, we don't have it on here, but we put an Alter Boy on it, Sound Toys Alter Boy. And messed around with the pitch and the formant a little bit. Not too much of the pitch, not too much of the formant, but just to give it a little bit of a lower texture to just add a little bit of excitement to the next section of this drop. And it sounds like this.
I just wanna ride right now. Everybody wanna take a bite right now. Ain't no time like a timeline now. Put it in my mouth and I might bite down.
Little Alter Boy.
Even if you don't like mess around with the formant and the pitch, Alter Boy's got this drive on it. It's a really tasty drive.
You really
just
put tasty.
Again, just cuts through the mix. Your vocals just pop out. It's quite magical.
We actually went and took that vocal then for the middle eight. So this is after the second drop to add a little bit of excitement and to add value to the song before we broke it down for a last time and then brought in for the last drop. We actually went and chopped it all.
Little chop chop.
Just a little one stop chop shop.
Listen to me.
So I mean, other people.
Do you want to explain how you chop?
Well, that's what I was gonna say. A lot of other people might have other ways of doing things. I mean, I know people might go and throw into a K-oscillator or whatever to get those results. Effects tricks is another one that they use that I used to have and I don't have it anymore. Like, I don't like that. Every day, I just wish I had that, but I don't. So I had to do it manually, but really what I did is just chop that vocal, chop out certain words and parts of the verse and just recreate a whole new thing. But in general, there's not really much to it other than just literally a little bit of audio chopping and whatnot. I don't even think I went and put any fades on it. Let's just have a look at that. Yeah, zero fading. So I mean,
you just took one line.
I'm gonna loop this as a triplet as well.
Cheap and cheerful.
Just be exactly. If you have one thing to explain it, don't think your editing has to be like precise. This is clear proof that you can do it cheap and cheerful and still yield the results you want.
Keep it moving.
Anyway, just chopping up vocals to make it interesting. Do whatever you want, editing. I mean, in general, we like to mix it up, but generally getting control of audio and having control over how we want it chopped and how we want it edited, fading it and doing all of these things, the more you lean into it, the more better results you're gonna get out of it. So in general, take your time with audio, get these results done. And I mean, to be fair, for what the tune is really, for the bulk of it. All of the sounds that we have, for the most part, are in this drop here. So I mean, I think that's pretty much everything we can show right now. Also, I mean, this song in general is a good testament to just keeping the core of everything as simple as you can, and instead of just adding things to keep it interesting, don't go back to all things that you have. Take that sample, that horn sample you have, reverse it, put some reverb on it, just like bounce in place there, reverse it. Do little things to make the most of what you already have instead of always just chucking things on top of it, because this project was a mess before we decided to clean it up and actually just hone in on what was actually important in the track.
Yeah. So just to give you a little story on like on our process of how we work, because obviously as you can tell, there isn't just one of us working. Like there's always at least two of us working on a project. So, and we all have our own laptops and we pass the projects around. So usually when we, as soon as we got something sounding decent, let's say the drums and the bass are sounding good, we start bouncing them into stems. Because otherwise, just like me passing a battery around to him and this and that, like once we got it sounding the way we want it, it's always better to bounce it into audio. Audio just gives you more freedom, you know? Like, because sometimes if you're just using batteries and the excesses and samplers, they don't always line up. When you got the wave, when it actually got the wave, you can see if it's lined up to your grid. And you could get things to sound tighter. So yeah, so just bounce things into place as soon as you can. And then you can play around with effects. If you don't like it, you can always go back and change it. But we always have multiple versions of each project. And yeah.
Which, looking just before we actually recorded this, we were looking at the project, and the project's 13.5 gigabytes. So
yeah.
Gives you an idea of what we're dealing with, right?
Yeah, that's probably because of all the samples. And our process is more sample-based, so we use tons of samples. We just like have like just terabytes of just samples just sitting there that we can
dig into, and it's still
loads of shit, man.
It's editing audio for the most part. Yeah. Our whole thing is, I mean, don't get me wrong, we have all our hardware and outboard gear, all of that, but generally we just spend 90% of the time editing audio.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's us three anyway. All right, we're Jaded. We hope you've enjoyed this video. Let us know what you think. We'll be in the comments section going for you if you've got anything good or bad to say. I'm coming for you.
Coming.
We're all coming for you. We've got a bunch of new music coming out in the coming months. Stay tuned. You can find us on all the usual platforms and whatnot. We are Jaded.